Welcome to episode 4 on Recorder Technique, and today we're going to talk about coordination, so air, articulation, and fingers. So here is where it all comes together. Before you watch this video, make sure you know the information that I've talked about in the other videos of this series. So air, articulation, and posture, which also includes fingers, embouchure, etc. Because in this video, I'm taking them all together. Apart from coordination between these three parts, we should also have a look at the coordination among themselves. So what do I mean with this? First, ask yourself the question, how is the coordination between my fingers? How is the coordination between my air? And how is the coordination between my different articulations? So I would say the magic word here is isolate. If something is not working well, if it isn't coming together well, then you have to isolate the different elements and see how they come together in the end. So let's start with the element of air. Of course, any change in air is always going to be paired with a change in fingers, but you can isolate the work you're doing specifically on the air, focusing on the way the air has to change, has to travel immediately from the center of one tone to the center of another tone. As I told you in the episode on air, you should try to find the center of each tone, right? So now the next step would be to combine them. So this you could do by making a scale, not too fast, and trying to connect the different centers with each other, if that makes sense. Of course, the faster you go, the less you can focus on consciously finding the center of each tone. So then it will have to be already a little bit more on a kind of automatic pilot and a connecting motion. Then you could do the same with thirds. If you didn't find it directly, you can repeat so that your body goes there directly. It's going to be different going up, then going down. Because going up means you're opening up a little bit, the air is going slightly faster, and going down means the air has to slow down. The same with fourth. You can also repeat the same interval until your body gets the feeling. Okay, and then bigger and bigger intervals, and then you can do the octaves. Difficult one. And actually make sure your thumb is going to have to close off the hole a little bit more for the higher notes. Just going a little bit higher, closing off like 80% of the finger hole normally. and the same going down. Be careful that you're not just dropping before the note when you're jumping down. Next, the articulations among themselves. So these would be all the different combinations. Before mixing them with the fingers, I would say you have to practice them on the same notes. So imagine you have a piece and the articulations are not going very well somehow. They're not going well with the fingers. Then practice the piece on one note with all the different combinations of the articulations. Then if you work with double articulations, you've already heard this in the episode on articulation, try to invert them. That's also a good trick. But remember that the articulations are always going to depend on this steady flow of air that's supporting the tongue. So somehow we already have a coordination between the air and the tongue. But okay, we were talking about focusing on one specific item, right? So you could also just take a pattern and play it on repeated notes, 4x4, for example. Or eight plus one. I've already given you a lot of exercises in the articulation video. So, and then the fingers. Well, you do need to focus on the coordination between the fingers. You really have to make sure that they collaborate, and your brain must really know which fingers are lifting up, which fingers are coming down. So when you've got a new piece, the first thing you have to do is practice it slowly and very consciously, because your brain is going to remember that first time. It's when the motoric memory is made. I always imagine it like this highway going from your hand to your head, but it's from all the muscles to the brain. So that's when in the brain is actually created this muscle memory. Therefore, your brain has to be present when you're doing the combinations. So that's why I always recommend slow and very conscious studying of pieces. Something very important is that the movement between all these fingers is going to have to be small, efficient, relaxed, and rounded. So we don't want this kind of movement. It's moving my entire hand. So if we need to do all those fork fingerings, we really want to have a movement that's very small, with relaxed shoulders, rounded, so we only use this part of the finger, and still efficient. No dancing around it, let's say. So when we've got these finger combinations, that's exactly what we want. We want the brain to know that, yes, finger two is going to lift and fingers three and four are going to be placed down. Okay, and what happens if some fingers are faster than others, or some fingers are just lazy and they're slower? For example, okay, this is a little bit exaggerated, but when you hear the plop, this, what you're actually hearing is, but very fast. So this means that finger two is a little bit slower than fingers three and four. So in that case, you will have to do the opposite. And that's lifting finger two earlier than finger three and four. So you're going to overdot it so much that in the end, it becomes a perfect coordination between the fingers. And there you've got it. So it's very good if even your mind is able to name the fingers it's moving. Your mind really has to know which fingers are moving when. Also, focus on the sensation of the lifting fingers versus the dropping fingers. It feels a bit different. Funnily enough, the work is against gravity. So actually, fingers that lift are working a little bit harder than fingers that just drop. And this is good to know for a trill. Another way of working on the combination of fingers is by changing the rhythm. So a good exercise would be dotted rhythm. If this is giving you trouble, for example, then you would practice dotted rhythm. So, why is that? Because for the brain, then it makes it actually easy. This for us is much easier than, it's like, oh, this big task. Whereas there my body says, oh, this is easy. And here the same. So you break it up in little pieces by dotting the rhythm and you just focus on individual changes. Then you can do it the opposite. So then you can do ta-da, 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 ta-da. From here you can do groups of 1 plus 2. Still a light task for the body. Normally you would shift that. In this case, it's already shifted. And then you would do 1 plus 3. This one I would have to shift. And for passages of more different notes, you would then add the number of fast notes. Little by little, breaking it always up in little groups. Great, so now we come to the combinations. Let's first go to the air plus the fingers. So for this work, your breath control already has to be solid. But now we really want to look at how does my air collaborate with my change of fingers, especially with jumps. How does my air adapt? Playing it slowly and noticing how you have to find the center of the tone each time, how your air connects the different registers, the different tones. Then air plus articulations. So the combination of air and articulation, you can find it perhaps in staccato. How does the air help with soft articulation in the high notes? But in general, it should always be active anyway. You will have to find the coordination between air and articulation in big jumps. But this is a combination that in itself is perhaps not the one that's most difficult if you've already worked on air plus register changes or jumps. And on the other side, have worked already on articulation in general, knowing that the air is always supporting that articulation. And now we come to the combination of tongue and fingers. Of course, the air is going to be there, right? Let's say that of the three combinations, this one perhaps is the most difficult one. So first of all, you will have to know that the tongue follows the fingers. The fingers are rhythmically a little bit more precise than the tongue. For me, it's very important to relax as much as possible when I practice the coordination between tongue and fingers. So the air is the big stream, the fingers and the tongue are light, floating on top. And don't forget to relax those shoulders, because they go up very quickly. When you're practicing a piece and you want to focus on this coordination between tongue and fingers, well, first you will have to find out where it works and where it doesn't work. And we want to practice the fragment where it doesn't work. So you have to isolate that part and then work on the fingers and be sure that they are well coordinated. Relax as much as possible because any tension means that you're actually working against yourself and against a good result. Then work with these rhythmic patterns. And I would also say that working on coordination requires a lot of attention on how do I feel? Is everything still relaxed? Are they working together? Working on coordination means relaxing as much as possible and being as precise as possible at the same time, focusing on two elements and how they work together. That's actually very zen. You have to be very relaxed and very alert.
For this last video of the series, there is a PDF on my webpage as well. Go to lapke.world. Then go to Documents, which can be found in the menu in the upper right corner, or by going down on the homepage. There you have the PDF on coordination, as well as all the other documents. And don't forget to subscribe to the email list if you wish to receive news from time to time.
And with this, we've come to the end of this video and also of this series on the recorded technique. Check out the other videos if you haven't already. And give this a video like if you thought it interesting, share it, follow me here on YouTube, and I'll be making other videos, so I'm sure I'll see you there. Bye!